Hello and praise the Lord. We thank God for the privilege of coming to you, to your houses, to speak to you the word of God. And I believe that the Lord will bless us and strengthen us as we go on with life. Shall we pray as we get started? Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for granting us this opportunity to come to you again and to reach your people in their houses. We want to thank you for the power of your word. You have shown us that there is no distance in the things of the spirit, and we pray that your presence, your power, the anointing of the Holy Spirit will reach every one of us that is connected to this service, wherever they are, that the sick be healed, that the bound be loosed, that the captives be set free, that the discouraged be encouraged, that the weak become strong by the integrity and the power of your word. We thank you for every one of us that is watching from wherever they're watching. We pray that you speak to all of us by the power of your word. We thank you, we give you praise, and we give you glory. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray and believe. Amen. Amen. This morning I want to share the word of God. I want to share with us on what I've entitled dealing with crisis. Dealing with crisis. Dealing with crisis. I wish that we read few scriptures and then we will take off from there. We begin with the Psalms. Psalms chapter 9, verse 9. We will also go to Psalms 27, verse 5. And then we will also read Psalms 46 and verse 1. Even before we read these scriptures, the Bible shows us that crises are bound to come, especially as we draw closer to the end time. The Bible is clear. The Bible is not silent about crises, about trouble. The Bible shows us that crises are bound to come and times are bound to come. That is what the scripture shows us. Psalms 9 verse 9. The Lord is our refuge. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed and stronghold in times of trouble. So the Bible is acknowledging that there is something called times of trouble. There is something called times of trouble. So the Bible is not silent when it comes to crisis. It is assuring us that crisis will come. But then God is not silent about crisis coming. God is never silent about any issue of life. So the Bible is showing us from that scripture, the Lord is a refuge. A refuge is more than just a place where we run. It is more than the place where we run to go and hide. It is a place of security. It is a place where we go and we are safe. We are protected. We are well kept. The Lord also will be a refuge for the oppressed. A refuge in times of trouble. In times of trouble. So the Bible is showing us there are times of trouble. And especially as we get closer to the end times, as we get closer to beginning of the end, the Bible is telling us that there will be times of trouble. Even in the journey of life, as you go on with your life as an individual, the assurance that the Bible is giving us is that there will be times of trouble. But then the Bible is showing us something in Psalms 27. Psalms 27 and verse number 5. Psalms 27 and verse number 5. Psalms 27 and verse number 5. Psalms 27. Psalms 27 and verse number 5. For in the time of trouble, again, the Bible is letting us know that there is such a time as a time of trouble. He shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me up upon a rock. For in the time of trouble, so there is something called the time of trouble. And according to God, the trouble, the crisis is not the problem. The issue is how we deal with the crisis. What are the provisions that God has given us to deal with the crisis? Even as we come to you live this morning, we want to assure you that whatever crisis that you go through, whatever trouble you may be going through right now, God has given a provision on how to deal with this crisis. The point I want to emphasize respectively is that there will be trouble. There will be time of crisis. Crises are bound to come. That is the reality of life. And as we get closer to the end time, we are certain. And I want to mention something about what is going on in the world today. And I want to respectively let us know that out there, things are bound to get even worse. Coronavirus is not even the worst. The Bible shows us there are worse things that will come towards the end of the age. But for us that knows the Lord, the Bible is not also silent about us. The Bible is telling us in that time of crisis, in that time of trouble, there is an hiding place. And we are not just running to hide. It is God himself hiding us in a secret place. So the Bible shows us that. I want to emphasize this, that all of us understand that the crises are bound to come. They must come. They must come. According to the words of Jesus in Matthew 24. I want us reading from Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. We are going to read a couple of verses from that scripture, Matthew chapter 24. We read from verse number 6, Matthew chapter 24. We read from verse number 6. And you shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. All these things must not may. The Bible is not saying that they may. The Bible is telling us that they must come. These things must come. Crisis must come. Trouble must come. But the end is not yet. Verse number 7. For nation shall rise against a nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes and in diverse places. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be
verse 7, please.
And there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in diverse places. This is making it clear to us that these things must come. Crisis must come. Issues must come. Trouble must come. But then, the Bible is giving us the assurance again in Psalms 46. Psalms 46, and we read from verse number 1. Then we pick up from there. God is our refuge. God is our place of security. When this crisis arises, we have good news. God, not the economy. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. So the problem is not the trouble. The problem is how we deal with the trouble. The Bible is saying, God, that is good news to all of us. It's good news to know that crisis will be there. The Bible has given us the assurance. Crisis will come. Issues will come. End times will come. The Bible shows us that end time, trouble will come. Especially now that we are drawing closer to the beginning of the end. But we have good news. God is our refuge and strength. A very present help in trouble. A very present help. So even in the midst of crisis, we are not helpless. The world might be helpless. The society may be helpless. But to us that know God, to us that believe in God, to us that trust God, the Bible is giving us the assurance that God is our refuge, is our place of security, is our place of protection, is our place of safety. And it's not only a place of safety. The Bible is telling us is also our strength. The strength of men today is melting. The strength of leaders, the strength of countries, the strength of nations, the strength of presidents, the strength of the world leaders is melting because of the many things that are happening in the world today. But to us, the Bible says, despite crisis, despite trouble, God is not only our place of safety, He is not only our place of security, He is also our strength. And not just strength that we run after, the very present help. He is the very present help. He is the very present help despite the trouble, despite the crisis. So, ladies and gentlemen, I come to your houses to let you know that in the midst of crisis, in the midst of what is happening in the world today, in the midst of meltdown of many things in the society today, we have been given the assurance that the Lord is our refuge. He is our place of safety. He is our place of safety. And therefore, and not only safety, is our strength. In Him we find strength. In Him we find help in the time of trouble. Verse 2. Let's look at verse 2 before we move on. Therefore will not we fear. Fear. Today, fear is becoming more famous than the coronavirus itself. Fear is even becoming more. People are more afraid. Fear is becoming more prominent than the corona itself, because that is what the devil is selling. But to us that know the Lord, the Bible is saying the Lord is our refuge and He is our strength, a very present help in the time of trouble. And because of that assurance, therefore we will not fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. These are crises. The Bible is describing crisis. Therefore, will we not fear, though the earth be removed And though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. Let's go to verse number 3. Though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountain shake with the swelling thereof. Let's keep going. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. That is to say, even when there is cry all over the place, God has given us a cause to rejoice, a cause to be happy. God is in the midst of our, God is in our midst. Despite the crisis, I want to encourage somebody. Despite the crisis, don't capitalize too much on the crisis, because the Bible is telling us, even in the midst of crisis, God is in our midst. God is among us. She shall not be moved. We will not be moved. God shall help us. And that right early. It will not come late. So, ladies and gentlemen, I want us to know that there are two facts the Bible is presenting to us. Fact number one is that crises are bound to come. Crises must come. These things must come. Fact number two, God has not left us without a provision, without something, without the way out. God has not left us at the middle of the road. He has always made provisions. And I want to say this. I want to give us this fact also, that every crisis has a spiritual dimension. Every crisis has a spiritual dimension. And God has given us spiritual means or spiritual ways of dealing with crisis, because every crisis has a spiritual dimension. We will be seeing that as we look at the divine provisions that God has given us, so that we may be able to contain and subdue and control and conquer crises as they come. And we want to take some time and share one or two provisions, because every time God gives us the assurance of something, the next thing God does, He gives us the provision to make the assurance a reality. If God says that we are safe, then He has made provisions for us to participate in the process of safety. Whatever God provides, whatever God assures, whatever God has promised, He has made provisions. Now that the Bible has shown us that crises are bound to come, crises must come, and then He has shown us that there is a way out, the next question we must ask ourselves, what are the provisions that God has given to us, so that we may conquer, we may use them as tools and weapons to conquer crises, to subdue trouble, to subdue issues that come against our lives. And then that is where we are picking from. Remember, every crisis has a spiritual dimension. Every crisis has a spiritual dimension, in the sense that most of the sources of crisis are not natural. So every crisis, it may look very natural, it may look very human, but every crisis has a spiritual dimension. And because of that, God has given us provisions. God has given us provisions on what to engage in dealing with the crisis. So the provision number one, our responsibility number one in order to subdue and conquer crisis, is you must know God as an individual, because crises don't come collectively. Crises come to individuals. It might be all over the world, but your life is an individual life. It's just a personal life. So the first thing God has provided, so that we may be able to conquer crisis, is that you may know Him as a person, as an individual, not as a church, not collectively, as an individual, as a person. as a person. You must know God as a person, because it is your knowledge in God. It is your knowledge in God that makes you strong. It is knowing God that builds your fortitude in order to handle crisis. It is when you know God, it is knowledge of God, a strength in itself. It's not only a source of strength, it is strength in itself, knowing God. The Bible says in Daniel chapter 11 and verse that 2, and they that know their God shall be strong, and they will do exploits. You cannot handle crisis effectively if you just know the God of our church, if you just know the God of my pastor, if you just know the God of that church, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac. It is good to know him as the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac. It is the basic, it is the foundation, but that will not help you in the time of crisis. Knowing God as the God of Abraham will not help you. It can boost your faith, but it will not help you to deal with the crisis when crisis comes. They that know their God, not they that know the God of others, they that know their God will be strong, and they will be able to combat, they will be able to confront, they will be able to conquer crisis. Knowing God as an individual is the key to strength that will enable you to deal with the crisis. You cannot deal with the crisis if you are dealing with the God of your church, just the God of your church. It is good to know him as the God of your church, but you need to go a little bit farther than that. You must know him as your God. Paul says, and my God, not our God, not the God. Remember the sons of Sceva, one of the reasons why the devil overpowered them is because they came with the God of Jesus and the God of Paul. They never said the God that we serve, the God that we know. It is the God that you know that will help you to handle the crisis of life, not the God of our church, not the God of my pastor. Thank God, he is the God of your pastor. Thank God, he is the God of your church. David says in Psalm 63 that early will I seek you to see your power and your glory, just like I have seen in the sanctuary. I don't want just to see power in the sanctuary. I don't just want to know the God of our church. I want to know him as my God. And they that know their God, to see thy power and thy glory, so as I have seen thee in the sanctuary. Yes, I have seen you as the God of the church. I have seen you as the God of so and so. I have seen you, you have given testimony to so and so. But you can't stop there. You can't stop there. You must go further and let God become your God. Know him personally. Know him as an individual, so that even as the time continues to become harder and harder, that you are no longer attending the church physically, you know God as an individual. He can work for you in the house. He can work for you in the office. He can work for you when you travel, because he is your God. He is not just the God of your church. David says, the way I have seen you in the church, I would want to see you. I want to see you in my life. In the beginning, in verse 1, he says, oh God, you are my God. Thou art my God. Thou art my God, not our God, not the God of Israel. David says, this in this matter, you are not our God. Life is not collective. Life is personal. It says, oh God, thou art my God. You are not our God. You are not the God of our church. You are all that. But in order for me to handle life effectively, he must be my God. He must be my God. Oh God, thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. Not early we will seek you. Early I will seek you. It's me. You are my God. Now early I will seek you. Whether there is anybody seeking you or not, early will I seek you. Whether there is attending church physically or not, early you are my God. Early will I seek you. Hardly will I seek thee, my soul, not our soul. My soul thirsteth for thee, my flesh, not our flesh. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry enters the land, life can become dry. Life can become thirsty. Where no water is. David says, you are my God. He knew God as an individual. He did not know God. There is a place for collective knowledge of God. And there is a place for you to know God personally. That even if crisis come to a point whereby there will be no church for the next 5 months, you will still be vibrant in your Christianity because you know God as a person, and there is no distance. God does not stay just in church. He is everywhere. And even in your house right now, I want you to know that whatever could have happened in the church can happen to you while you are in your house, because you know him as your God, not just our God. The knowledge of God does not only make you strong, it enables you to do exploits. One of the exploits that every believer must do is to handle crisis effectively, is to deal with the trouble when they come. And I want to encourage everybody this morning that if you know God as an individual, when there are news all over the place, they don't shake you. They are not carrying you away. You know that the God that you know is not far from you, because you know him as an individual. You don't know him collectively. It is not a church thing. It is not a religious thing. It is a personal thing. And such as do wickedly against the covenant shall be corrupt by flatteries. But the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. The greatest source of energy is the knowledge of God. The greatest source of your spiritual energy is by knowing God as an individual, as a person. It will work for you everywhere you go. Number two, if you want to deal with the crisis effectively, now that the Bible has shown us and proven to us that crisis are bound to come, Matthew 24, he said, these things are bound to come. These things must come. These things must come. These things must come. Must come. These things must come to pass. These things must come to pass. Before Jesus comes, these things must come. Crisis must come. Trouble must come. Betrayal must come. Difficulty times must come. That is the reality of the word of God. But then, God did not leave us at the middle of the road. He has made provisions. He has told us, this is how you handle when these things come. This is how you handle them. Number two, you must stabilize and develop your prayer life as a person. You must stabilize. Your prayer life must become stable. Not doing it today, not doing it tomorrow. Your prayer life must become stable. And you must grow in it. Every provision of God has the provision for growth. Whatever God provides, it has the capacity for growth. So your prayer life can grow. But we grow from a position of stability. The tree must have its root down before it goes upward. The house must have a foundation going down before it begins going upwards. We grow from the position of stability. We develop from the position of stability. The anchors of growth is stability. Your prayer must be stable. Your prayer must be constant. Because crises will not wait for you to prepare. They come like a thief. Trouble comes like a thief. Crises come uninvited. The enemy comes without invitation. You must work on your prayer life. Remember, I told you that every crisis has a spiritual dimension. Every crisis, a as a spiritual consideration, as a spiritual dimension. The Bible shows us in Psalms chapter 91, Psalms 91 in verse 1, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. He that dwelleth, not he that visits, that is stability. What is that secret place of the Most High? It is the place of prayer. The secret place of the Most High is the place of prayer. Consistent prayer. That is the secret place of the Most High. And the Bible says, that person who stays, who has stabilized his prayer life, he will abide under the shadow. That means that he will abide under the security. Shadow means security, protection, covering. He will live under the covering of the Almighty. We celebrate Psalms 91, but in order for us to effectively celebrate the Psalms 91, we must appreciate verse 1, because verse 1 is what makes the rest of Psalms 91 effective. Verse 1, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. That is the foundation. That is where other verses are getting their fortitude and courage and strength from, that verse. Then verse 2, we can now see, because he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High will abide under the wings. I think there are some versions that talks about the wings. Some versions is under the shadow. It all means the same. It's the covering of God. When coronavirus comes, they that dwells in the secret place of the Most High, they shall be covered by God in the secret place. That happens in the secret place. Then after you fortify your secret place, now you can say, I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him I will trust. Verse 3, surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence, because of verse 1. All these other verses to verse 16, they are not relevant without verse 1. They draw their energy from verse 1. He that dwells in the secret place, because it is dwelling in the secret place that guarantees us the covering, that guarantees us the security, that guarantees us the shadow of the Almighty. The dwelling. He that dwelleth in the secret place. In combating and conquering the crisis that will keep coming, prayer is not one of the options. Prayer is the main option. Is the main thing. Among many things we must do, prayer, fortifying your prayer, working on your prayer, developing your prayer, stabilizing your prayer. The Bible says in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, as we begin to wind up now, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, we are going to read verse 12 to 15. This is another dimension. I told you that every crisis has a spiritual dimension. They may bring it medically, scientifically, but every crisis has a spiritual dimension. And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer. Here comes prayer again. And I've chosen this place to myself for an house of sacrifice. If I shut, it is God shutting now. It's not the devil shutting. This is a spiritual thing. If I shut up heaven, that is, this is God speaking to Solomon. He says, if I shut up heaven, that there be no rain, or if I command the locust, we were dealing with locusts the other day, to devour the land, or if I send pestilence like coronavirus, pestilence among my people, if my people, this is now the solution, this is the provision, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. When crisis as a spiritual source that is positive, that is God, if a crisis is coming from God, you cannot pray it away. There are two elements, there are two provisions that God has given to deal with the crises that are from him, because God did not leave us at the middle of the road. If a crisis, if trouble is coming from the Lord, if the trouble we are experiencing as the hand of God over it, we cannot bind it, we cannot rebuke it, we cannot cast it out. There are two provisions he has given us. Number one, repentance. That's what he is saying. If my people will turn away from their sin, I will forgive. There is no forgiveness without repentance. No forgiveness without repentance. You cannot bind any crisis that has the hand of God over it. You cannot bind a problem that God is involved. God is saying, if I shut heaven, it's not the devil shutting heaven, it is me shutting heaven. If I shut heaven, if the plagues come, if crises come, which are the origin from me, then you cannot bind it. You cannot rebuke it. You cannot cast it out. The key number one is repentance. He says, if I'm turned from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. So the provision that God has given for any crisis that is divinely related, that is divinely connected, is repentance. Number two, provision is the mercy of God. The children of Israel, they understood the mystery of mercy. That is why anytime they were confronted by their enemies, they did not only rely on their military might, they did not just rely on their power, on their own power. Actually, they understood this mystery so much that they developed a song, "For the Lord is good and his mercies endure us forever." For the Lord is good. It is the mercies of God that will. The mercy of God simply means exemption from judgment. It means God looking on the other side from our mistakes. That is what the mercy of God means. And it's in the Bible, the provisions of God. It is only the mercy of God that comes on daily basis. It is for your mercy that we are not consumed. For your mercies are new every morning. Your mercies are new every morning. Not every week. Not every year. Every morning. Because the mercies of yesterday cannot work today. He has made a provision. God has made a provision that if a crisis, trouble is from him, is related with him, then we must engage the mystery of his mercy and the mystery of repentance. The Bible says, the other dimension of the Bible says that, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood." For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. We don't fight against flesh and blood. Every crisis has a spiritual dimension. Every crisis, every trouble has a spiritual dimension. The instruments might be physical. The instruments might be natural. But every crisis, every problem, "For we wrestle not against flesh." So there is a wrestling here. There is a wrestling going on. "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places."
So the Bible is letting us know there is a warfare. So any crisis that we are certain that it is not from God, it is not related with God, the Bible tells us that there is a warfare we have to engage. We must engage warfare. We must engage the blood of Jesus. We must engage the sword of the Spirit. We must engage the power of God. So the Bible talks of praying with all kinds of prayer. You must understand and know and discern what kind of prayer you must engage in what crisis. Crises are not the same, and you cannot engage the same kind of prayer. The Bible says praying with all kinds of prayers. Praying with all kinds of prayers. Praying with all kinds of prayers. There are kinds in prayers. Praying always with all prayer and supplication. Give us NIV. I'm praying the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. So, before you approach crisis and trouble in prayer, you must discern the trouble. What kind of trouble is this? Where, what is the source of this trouble? Could God be involved? Could God be the hand of God is on this? Is there a possibility that God is involved in this crisis? And by discerning that, you are able to know what kind of prayer to engage in that crisis. All crises are not the same. All crises don't have the same source. All crises don't have the same backup. All crises must not have the same approach. It is discerning the source and the cause of crisis that tells you what kind of prayer to engage. I want to encourage every child of God. Fortify your prayer life. Grow in your prayer life. It is not optional for a child of God that desires to be victorious in their Christian adventure. Prayer is not optional to them. Prayer is not optional to that, to us. He says, if my people who are called by my name, let's finish that scripture. If my people who are called by my name, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Look at the last verse. Now mine eyes shall be open and mine ears attend unto the prayer, not unto the discussions, unto the prayer that is made in this place. Church is a place of solution if the church becomes a praying church. The church becomes a place of solutions, encouragement, hope, if it becomes the place of prayer. Now mine eyes shall be open and mine ears attend unto the prayer, not unto the discussions, not unto the stories, unto the prayer that is made in this place. The church is a solution center, is the place where we find solutions to the problems. The problems of the society will not be solved out there. No, God has not structured it that way. But the church must be encouraged to become a praying church. Stabilize and develop your prayer life. If you involve prayer in every area that you are involved in, if you engage prayer in everything that you are undertaking, you are on the advantage. Because prayer gives you advantage. And finally, if you want to effectively subdue crisis, you must stabilize your spirituality by the working knowledge of the Word of God. By the working knowledge of the Word of God. You don't know the Word of God just like a storybook. Reading about God does not give you access into the provisions of God. Having the knowledge of God is what gives you provision. They are different. It's what gives you the provisions of God. You can read the Bible and read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation and still not have the knowledge of what you are reading. And still you don't understand. It's just a story. You must have the knowledge, the working knowledge of the Word of God, to the point that you have not just read a scripture. You can read the scripture and go and intelligently apply what you read. That is what we call understanding. When you are able to apply, effectively apply. Remember, all things are held by the power of His word. All things. He holds all things by the word of His power. He holds the reason why the sun has never moved one inch. The reason why the moon has never moved one inch. The reason why the earth has never moved one inch. Where God placed it is where it remains. When God said, "Let there be," that word has been holding all things together. That word that God spoke in Genesis, "Let there be." He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. Hebrews 1 and verse 3. The sun is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of His being, sustaining all things by His powerful word. Sustaining all things by His powerful word. After He had provided purification for sins, He sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. He holds, He sustains all things, not some things. He sustains all things by His powerful word. As we wind up, I want to mention the last point. The more you grow in the word, the more effective you become in handling crisis. The more you grow in the knowledge of scriptures, in the knowledge of the word of God, not just in reading, in knowledge, in application. And we know that you have the knowledge of the scriptures by the way you apply the scriptures in your situations, not by how many scriptures you can memorize, how many scriptures you can quote. You can quote it and not work for you. But we know that you have the knowledge of the Word of God by the way you apply the Word of God in your situations. The way you apply the Word of God in your situations. That is what tells us. That is the proof that you have the knowledge of the Word of God. By the way you apply. By the way you engage practically what you have read in your situations. If you are sick and you have read about your health, the way you engage and apply the scriptures in your situation of sickness is what tells that you have the knowledge of the scriptures. Otherwise, besides that, you just have the information. Information transforms when it becomes understanding, when it becomes knowledge, not just being informed. Number 4, and I close at this,
and then we are going to pray. Number four. Number four, you must learn the heart of speaking to your crisis. A speaking believer is a strong believer. A speaking believer. The enemy wants to use situations and circumstances to silence you because he knows. He wants to present situations before you. And then he suggests to you, you can't talk now. You can't confess what you are confessing. It is contrary to what you are saying. But I want you to know that one of the privileges God has given to us is that of speaking. One day, Jesus was sailing together with his disciples, and a serious storm just came down suddenly. And the Bible says that the disciples were running here and there. Helter skelter, telling Jesus, we are about to die. And Jesus, when Jesus stood, he did not just stare at the situation. That was a crisis. They were almost dying in the water. It was a serious crisis. When Jesus stood, when Jesus woke up, the Bible says, and Jesus rebuked. Then he arose and rebuked the wind. He spoke to the wind. Everything in this life has ears. And remember, we said every crisis has a spiritual dimension. So he rebuked the wind and the raging of the water, and they ceased. They stopped. The water stopped what it was doing. The wind stopped what it was involved in. The waves stopped because they heard. Jesus spoke to the tree. Jesus spoke to the water. Jesus spoke to the storms. Jesus knew the mystery of speaking. He did not keep quiet in his crisis. This was a crisis that was confronting not only the disciples but the very Son of God. And he stood, he woke up, and did not just stand there and smile to the crisis. He did not stand there and wonder what is happening. He spoke to his crisis. I want to encourage every believer, don't let Satan silence you. Don't let Satan mute you. Don't let Satan take away your confidence of speaking. Job says, you shall also decree a thing and it shall be established. Thou shalt also decree a thing and it shall be established unto thee. And the light shall shine upon thy ways. The light can only shine because you are speaking the right thing. Say what God is saying. Confess what God says. Confess what God has already said in his word. The power of life and death is not in the hands, is not in the mind, is not in the heart. The power of life and death is in the tongue. And they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Proverbs 18. The power of life and death is in the tongue. Dead and life. Remember, every crisis that is continuing has life in it. And the way to suck that life out of it is by speaking against it. Speaking to it. Because every crisis, every trouble has ears. The waters hard. The wind hard. The storms hard. And they obeyed because everything in this life has ears. Let's look at verse 20. Verse 20. A man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, not the fruit of his hand. And with the increase of his lips shall he be filled. They know that is the foundation, and then death and life are in the power of the tongue. The power
power of speaking. Remember, everything you are dealing with can respond to your speaking, because you are not just speaking, you are also speaking on behalf of Jesus. You are his representative. Whatever crisis you will go through now and in the future, remember, one of the ways of subduing it and conquering it is speaking to it what you believe in from the word of God. I wish we stop at that today, and I want us to pray. Wherever you are, you can join me in prayer now, because the Lord has promised he will be with you. He is with us. He is not just in heaven, he is with us. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, your word has come. You have given us the privilege to release your word through the airwaves. Now we release your word of healing through the airwaves, that anyone that is watching us that is sick, we curse the sicknesses now. We curse the diseases now. We curse every pain. We command every pain to leave their bodies in the name of Jesus. And Lord, I pray that every crisis, every trouble, every situation that your people might be going through right now, Lord, according to your word, let every crisis be subdued. Let every trouble be subdued. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that you visit your people now, dealing with every crisis, dealing with every trouble, dealing with anything that is a concern to your people. In the name of Jesus Christ, let the sick be healed. Let the bound be set free. Let the captives be set free right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, show yourself strong on behalf of your people, Lord. Show yourself strong on behalf of your people. In the name of Jesus, we speak to crisis. We speak to the problems. We speak to the challenges that your people have been going through. We command the storms. We command the wind. We command the waters to cease in the name of Jesus. The violence of life to cease in the name of Jesus. The hostility of life to cease in the name of Jesus. Show yourself strong, faithful God. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor. Visit your people right now. Right in their houses. Right in their working places. Wherever your people are right now. Reach them. Let them have experiences with you. Let them have experiences with you in the name of Jesus. Let the pain leave now. Let the affliction disappear right now in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We give you glory. We give you praise. The last prayer we want to pray, possibly you are watching us and you are wondering what you can do to give your life to Jesus. The greatest miracle that can ever happen to any man or any woman is when they give their lives to Jesus. Their sins forgiven, and they become the children, the sons of God. If you are there and wondering, what can I do, Pastor? I have heard the word. I have known that crisis will come. They will even get worse out there. But I want to have the confidence that God has provided to his people. Well, it is simple. The Bible says, with the heart we believe, and confession is made with our mouth, and we are saved. So I want to give you that opportunity to give your life to Jesus, to make things right with God. Wherever you are, ako hapo, ako kwa nyumba yako, ako mahali umekaa sasa hivi, naomba uombe haya maombi nyuma yangu. Sema, Bwana Yesu, nakuja kwako, nisamehe dhambi na makosa yangu. Futa jina langu kwa kitabu cha mauti. Niandike leo kwa kitabu cha uzima. Nimeamini, nimeokoka.
kwa jina la Yesu Kristo nimeomba na kuamini. Amen. If you said that prayer, be sure that you are a child of God. You are now born again. Wherever you are watching from, I encourage you, find a church that is preaching Christ, that is preaching the legitimate word of God, and become a member there and grow in the knowledge of Christ. Grow in Him so that you may grow to a point of serving Him. We thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for speaking to us today. We appreciate you. Thank you for giving us a wonderful Sunday. Thank you for giving us a wonderful moment, reaching out to the homes and the houses of your people and wherever your people have been listening and watching from. We thank you that your purposes are established. We thank you that that which you wanted be done, you have done it, and your name be glorified. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor for the testimonies of healings, for the testimonies of restorations, for the testimonies of what you have done in the lives of your people. Blessed be your name. In Jesus' precious name, we pray and we believe. Amen.